Beautiful. Oh gosh. Welcome to everyone here. It's so great to see my screen lighting up here. This is really beautiful. We are here on Zoom. Some of you are here on YouTube, some on Facebook. We say a huge warm welcome to all of you this evening or this afternoon, wherever this finds you, or this morning. A few, we may have some on the other side of the sun and earth here. Welcome, welcome, welcome. This is an evening when we celebrate a new creation. I always think of bringing a new CD into the world. It's a bit like a birth too. The works themselves have already been birthed, but here we get to really bring them into the world too. And so we're doing this midwife work here of carrying these works yet a stage further where it can be shared universally. These works can be listened to by many around the globe and repeatedly. So not just for one concert performance, but as many times in the comfort of your place, under your headphones, in your favorite chair, in your car, your favorite devices. So we're so excited to be here this evening. Welcome 1,000 times. I wanna say welcome to so many of you from around the country and a few around the globe too. We're really, really thrilled to have you all here. And to see all of you artists, this is really thrilling. This is a celebration of all of you. Composers, singers, guitarists. I'm sitting here at my piano, but a piano was absolutely unneeded for this project. And so we were piano free, which was kind of amazing and thrilling in its own way. Before we go any further this evening, I just want to take a moment to acknowledge our time in this world, in this human life, as a human family, as we move forward day by day, a time of great strife and suffering, a time for many of great loss on so many levels, certainly with the pandemic that has affected all of us in one way or another, and some people particularly more devastatingly, with a hurricane happening just south of where we are here in Austin, with wildfires up and down the West Coast, with time of great political unrest, a time of great, just maybe a beginning of a hope that we can heal the great racial wound here in America, and many other stresses and strifes. And then all of the layers of that with the economic challenges right now and many unemployed. So it's a tender time, a challenging time. And I want to acknowledge that anytime we come together as a human family and as a Kunstbrauerei-centered family here, just to acknowledge that, we hope that this evening can, one, be a touch point for us just to be together, to remember beauty in life, to remember what it is to be live and sharing music, sharing poetry, sharing our hearts and our feelings and the impulses that bring music forth into the world. And that hopefully this product, this CD too, can be a piece of your toolkit, something that you can explore and be with musically for your own inspiration, for your own accompaniment to the days that you have in the work that we have ahead. So I acknowledge that with all of our hearts and all spirits joined here, with great gratitude for everybody here. A couple of things I want to tell you. For those of you who are on Zoom, we have ambassadors who are providing instructions in the chat on how to have the best experience with Zoom. So if you have any Zoom challenges, check in with them. If you just type something in that chat, they will be on you like what? Something on a something. So we have great ambassadors ready to help. We're also giving away some prizes. Isn't that fun? So please stay tuned, and that will be in the chat as well. So this is a day of celebration, though, as I said, and we're celebrating particularly the artists who created this work, the artists who created the works first, and then the artists who brought them into this world. Before we chat with some of our folks, I wanted to just share a little something. Annette Carlozzi is a wonderful artist in her own right here in Austin, Texas. She wrote a beautiful essay about this project, which some of you might have seen. It's been shared in emails and has accompanied some of the CDs if you've ordered hard copies. But I thought I might just read the last couple short paragraphs of what she wrote about this project, because it says it in a way. It was a preparatory essay for this, but also tells us a little bit about what you're hearing. She says, resonating from a place of collective wisdom and trust, the singing guitar is an album of stories, especially women's stories and women's voices. As composer, writer, singer, guitarist, soared deep and wide in a company of excellence. Within these four unique ensembles, we receive the talents of Nobel laureates, Fulbright scholars, Grammy winners, mystics, and mavericks. A typical conspirare melange of mastery and commonality, assembled to transport us beyond ourselves to a shared space of open-heartedness. Oh, how desperately we want to create that now. This music, crafted by so many hands and voices, and yielding to interpretation by composers, conductor, performers, listeners, all. This recording meets each of us where we are. Can it inspire and activate us too? In the aftermath of hard-won histories like those mused upon here, can we access the wonder of how little we are, the grace of weird beauty? Inspired by brave protagonists coming to terms with profound challenges, this music offers models of resilience. I shall be beautiful while the earth lasts. I live in the hope of meeting. Exquisite, impossible, bittersweet. Deep exhale. Thank you, Annette. Thank you so much for those words which frame our time here together so beautifully. As we go on with our celebration here, I want to have us share a little bit of an artist montage. So this is just a way for all of you who are here to see the faces. It's a quick visit of each of the faces of the artists that we'll be able to see with a little bit of a musical background that comes from the CD. So let's watch that now. Oh, thank you. That was so beautiful to see all these faces, such gorgeous human beings. As has been noted in a number of places, and I saw it coming up in the chat too, this is a huge collaborative effort. And also want to say thank you to the wonderful staff at Kunstbrauerei. It just takes so many people even to gather photos and to be able to see these people. I don't know how it is for all of you, but I know for me during this COVID time particularly, it's just especially moving to see people we have been in a room with. We've been able to hug, we've been able to share meals so easily, so freely, something I think we will probably never take for granted again. So it's beautiful to see these wonderful colleagues and collaborators, so gorgeous. As all of you know, we there are four works represented on this CD, three guest composers. I wrote a very short piece just to begin the program when we did it live, and now it's the last track on the CD, but three very important composers here. And three extraordinary instrumental ensembles with Kunstbrauerei, the Los Angeles Guitar Quartet, Texas Guitar Quartet, and Austin Guitar Quartet. So just so such distinguished collaborators and a joyful process in doing this. We're going to first have a short conversation just saying hello to our composers, two of whom could be with us tonight. We're absolutely delighted. So I think maybe if you want to unmute Kyle and Rina. And just first of all, just maybe wave and give us a verbal hello first, Rina, and then Kyle, so people can kind of identify you. And I think we may be spotlighting you too.
Hi everyone. I'm Rina here from Pasadena, California. So nice to see all of you. Just hi. I'm glad to be here.
So glad you're here. Kyle, where is your face? There it is.
Hey everybody, I'm Kyle, and it's such an honor to be here just outside of Philadelphia and to be with Rena and Nico's music and Craig's music. And just an honor to be with all these wonderful musicians. Seeing these faces, Craig, you're absolutely right. It breaks my heart and it fills my heart at the same time.
Isn't that right? That's beautifully said. Yes. I wish we could do like a 3-hour visit with you. I think I want that experience for our guests here to be able to kind of hear into your minds and your spirits and hearts. Our time is, of course, very limited. So I think what I'd love to do is maybe start with you, Rina, just and then we'll have a chance to hear a little bit of your music together. But Rina, just take this from any angle you'd like, but talk to us a little bit about this project and the piece itself. Just a short intro, I think, for folks who haven't heard it and your journey with it would be wonderful.
Yeah, I mean, there's so much to say about this work because it originated actually as a work for choir and cello. And even then, I had been commissioned by a different choir. I wanted to write a totally different work. I was halfway through it. And then a friend of mine sent me a text of a Hafiz poem that he had found just in a random bookstore in Aspen where he happened to be giving a talk. And I just chucked everything out and started again because this text, when the violin can forgive the past, the heart starts singing. I thought, gosh, what an amazing, beautiful, evocative thing, and how amazing it would be to live with these words. And I mean, so many things have happened with the piece since then. It became there was a solo violin version made of it. Of course, we did this amazing version with guitars, which I'll tell you to return to in a moment. And the person who sent me the text became my husband in that time. So it's a piece, sometimes these things really generate these beautiful things in your life. And it's amazing to be associated with Kunstbrauerei. As I was looking at the singers all come up, I realized how many of you I know from various places, from Yale, from other places, and how small this world is, and how glad I am to be with you all virtually, because I don't know if we would have been able to all find our way together in person. So, I mean, it's wonderful to be here for that reason. And then also, I mean, to work with LA Guitar Quartet, what was so funny is, I mean, for any of you who live in California, and especially in Los Angeles, you basically have to drive to go to your neighbor's house if it's everything is that far apart and takes so long to get to. But I realized that the Guitar Quartet rehearsed distance from my house. I mean, how funny in this huge city that we just found each other and we created this arrangement, actually asked the poet, the translator, Daniel Ladinsky, if we could change the text to "When the Guitar." So I love that this piece has its own identity and its own sound world that feels so different from the way I had conceived it for solo cello. So yeah, this is "When the Violin," about forgiveness and about singing as a light that comes through forgiveness.
Beautiful. Thank you. It's so great. You were neighbors. That's just amazing. I know. And when we were kind of looking at the scope of this, I just knew in my gut, when we try and think what goes first on the CD, what goes next, what's the order, just this had to open the door for this CD. And I can't think of a more appropriate time for this to enter, this song about extraordinary, sort of the transformative choice of forgiveness, and then the singing that comes from that. It's beautiful. We're going to listen to about 4 minutes of it. It's a little bit longer, so we are apologizing to Rena and everyone that we don't get to hear the whole thing, but we'll hear about 4 minutes. There's some really cool, well, we don't have to, I know we don't have to, let's listen, and then you can read notes and learn more about this piece. So let it tease you, because there's a lot I'd like to say too. Here we go. John, go for it.
Thank you.
Beautiful. Rena, thank you for this very special piece. Thank you so much. Artists, thank you for your gorgeous performances. Exceptional. I can't wait for you to hear that too. And I want to thank John Stinson too, who really does everything possible to make our sound good in these mediums. It's not easy to do. And I know my sound is really lovely here through my computer. And when you get to your own ears, your own devices, you'll enjoy it directly even more without a Zoom or a YouTube connection. But John, thank you. It's just superb. I want to mention too, Kunstbrauerei is kind of well known at a little place in Austin here called Waterloo Records. Waterloo is an independent record store that's hanging on, and we all want to do everything. Just send them a check if you have an extra $10, or just, you know, support them so they can make it through this time. But we usually have our release parties. We often have had them there. And, you know, this is a place that's the local place where all the biggies, you know, if it's Patty Griffin or Willie Nelson or you name it, they'll do their release parties there because that's the spot in Austin. But Kunstbrauerei has, the little nonprofit train that could, you know, has been a group that, you know, the classical choir that comes in, and they always love it when we come because we can kind of keep up with the best of them. We had the best release. I think it was like 400 CDs sold at one of our events a few years back. And they just love it. Like, yes, let's get Kunstbrauerei to come. Because, and what Waterloo does too is they'll bring a keg of beer. And so you just grab that beer. It's really comfortable, really lovely. We hang around in this super small space, you know, in the aisles, the record aisles, if you will, the CD aisles now. And that's kind of, if you can kind of just get your mood on there, that's what we're doing here. So don't miss what Kyle has to say here, but just when you get a moment, if you want to grab something from your fridge, if you're a beer drinker, great. If you just like something else, or just I want you to have that vibe to know we are celebrating today. This is a party. We've always had fun, but what's great about this is we can have this national international party, which is so great. So I want to talk to you, Kyle, a second, and would you just talk to us, Kyle? We've had the pleasure of collaborating with Kyle on a few projects, and a very special one coming up, which we'll get to tell you about down the road. But today, this extraordinary work, The Dawn's Early Light, which came about just before this project came into being. He was able to dance on jump on a moving train here in several months just before this project. And a work that came through is just extraordinary. We love it. It's a multi-movement work. Kyle, what do you want us to know about this? What do you want to tell us, anything about your journey or the piece, or just in this moment, share from you about The Dawn's Early Light?
First of all, Rena, what a lovely work. What an absolutely gorgeous, gorgeous work. That was a home run. I mean, and to lead off the CD with that, Craig, is absolutely perfect. You know, the beginning of that, Rena, is just composer talk here. You know, you wrote that hook, and I'm absolutely hooked by that. And I've been ever since I heard it. And I go, oh, that piece. And that's what you want to do with every piece I want to do. You get the audience and you just hold them by the scruff of the neck and you hold them, and you don't let them go. That's what you did. Aww. And don't let anyone hear the rest of the piece. You got to buy the CD, hear the rest of it. So first of all, I'm so, so blessed to be on this CD with you, Rena. So great stuff. And Nico's piece is such a substantial work, and it was one that Kunstbrauerei has lived with for a few years. And Craig, you and I were talking about Nico's piece, and it was about the pioneer women who had come across the land, and we were talking about maybe seeing if we could find other voices from a different point of view. And so I was looking around for a long time, and then came upon this writing by Sarah Winnemucca, who is a Paiute Native American in what is now Nevada. And this book that she wrote it in her middle age, but it was mostly her experiences as a young girl. She was a remarkable woman and came to be a great spokesperson for her people. through the great sadnesses that they went through and the oppressions that they went through, and that they were kicked out of their land and moved. And she witnessed all this, and she tried to, she went around the country, the East Coast at that time mostly, giving lectures. And this book really struck me. So I read the whole, all of it. And, you know, it's one thing to be grabbed by a story, a text, and then you have to say, well, how can I set this to music? You know, it's an entire book. And so picking out different stories. And I have to say, the one thing that when I read it, I said, well, I have to set this. And it's the most amazing story of when she sang the Star Spangled Banner. Now, the Star Spangled Banner, of course, wasn't written until, you know, it was 1812. And it wasn't really known. It wasn't the national anthem then, but it became, you know, kind of more and more well known. Well, Sarah was born in the early 1840s. Her grandfather, who was a tribal chief, befriended the whites, and there were the white soldiers who came, and he was glad that they came. I won't give you the whole story, but he became a guide for them and got to know the soldiers. And so he learned all these songs that the soldiers were singing, including the Star Spangled Banner. He taught the Star Spangled Banner to his people. So Sarah Winnemucca grew up, so she would have been in the 1840s, 1850s, singing the Star Spangled Banner. I mean, this just blew my mind, first of all. And then the story gets even better. There was a time when she heard all the white people get together, the soldiers, and they sang the Star Spangled Banner. Well, it didn't sound anything like what she had learned. So what she was singing wasn't what they were singing. And so this became such an amazing story to me. And I thought, well, I want to set this to music, but how do you set this to music? So I thought, well, if I set the Star Spangled Banner to music, but like changed it all around, like the actual tune that everyone knows, people would think that I was just making fun of it. You know, if I started writing all these crazy chords or something like that. And I thought, no, I don't want to do that. I want to treat it with respect, like I treat everything with respect. And so I ended up just writing totally new music. And that became the core of the entire piece. So I have the stories leading up to this, and then that's kind of, and then a denouement coming out of that. But the main thing I wanted to try to apprehend was that this was a young girl, to see this through the eyes of the young girl. And so she talks about, yes, the Star Spangled Banner, but then also the atrocities. The soldiers came and killed uncles of hers and people she knew for no reason at all. And she was a witness to all this. And yet she was a witness to good things too. And all this came together in this one young girl's life, and that she is writing this. So I thought, how do I make sense of all this? I think the way that any composer makes sense of anything is that you have to find those things that are common to all of us, and to try to bring that out in the music. And when she said that, you know, look on me, I am beautiful. And I think, Craig, that was something that really spoke to you also. And in our going back and forth, I was throwing texts at you and saying, what about this? What about this? Mm-hmm. And so that's how the whole piece came together. It ended up being a little bit, I think, longer. I think we were talking about 15 minutes. It ended up being like 19 or 20 minutes. But you didn't yell at me, so I thought that was okay.
We're so grateful. No, I'm so glad you could have said it another 5 minutes and we would have been just delighted. Thank you so much, Kyle. You know, and this, we're going to listen to a one movement, a different movement than what Kyle referenced here. But when you get the CD and get a chance to listen, please be sure you find your way also, of course you will, to the Star Spangled Banner, this version of it. We had an extraordinary moment in recording it too, just on the very last day. We were all quite exhausted. And then suddenly the life force kind of came through the singers in this moment, and it was a very special memory. And so it imprinted there. So we're going to listen to a movement called The Plutes Are Not Fond of Going to War. I thought this also featured some very virtuosic guitar writing. You get to hear the Los Angeles Guitar Quartet really doing their thing, a lot of active choral writing. And so let's have a listen to that now, John, to the Kyle Smith movement. Extraordinary work, the whole thing. This is amazing. Thank you so much. So some of you might have heard a very cello-like sounding guitar. a fantastic guitarist here, cellist that is, who I wanted to save to share. Also Douglas Harvey, who's on the meeting with us here, a virtuoso cellist and virtuosic cello writing. Just an absolute dream to work with Doug, and he plays so gorgeously. How exciting. I want you to hear the whole work. So, and when you get the CD or listen to it, Spotify or any, be sure if you have wonderful headphones, do that, or get close within your system. I had the most glorious time editing this CD with our colleagues, Andreas and Jen, to be able to hear the detail in the cello and guitar writing too, which you will enjoy up close in those ways. Kyle, thank you for this gorgeous piece, and just for such collaboration, and wow. Nico Muli could not be with us tonight. He's in San Francisco, has a rehearsal happening. He's conducting something in some format, but was very sorry he couldn't be here. So we're gonna get to see Nico just for a couple minutes. We got him to pre-record a hello, and we're gonna hop into that. And I wanna say right on the heels of Nico's short video, there will be a little bit of a montage of some musicians sharing a moment or two about this project too, so you'll hear that. I wanted to mention also before we watch this video that Nico shared a little bit longer, and if you're interested in catching that too, we will be posting that on Facebook, on our Conspirare Facebook page. And he really shared many thoughts, but some very passionate thoughts too about the pandemic too, which if you're interested, please do check that out because there's more that he's sharing too. But here's just a little snippet from Nico and then some of our artists, and then we'll come on the backside and talk to a few of these artists live too. Thanks everybody.
Hello, it's Nico Muley from New York. I'm in my apartment where I've been for the last 6 months. And welcome. Glad that we can enjoy this moment, however obliquely, together. So How Little You Are was one of the stranger commissions I've ever got for 12 guitars and choir. And right away I knew that that was gonna present a problem for text, because you need text that justifies the existence of 12 guitars, which is hard to find. So I thought that what would be a good challenge was to find outdoor music. So music that relates in some way to, the natural world. I'd set a lot of text that was fussy, kind of 15th century, poems and things that take place on the internet and little pieces of prose. So I was looking for prose still, not poetry, but prose to set, which in some way required there to be 12 guitars. So what I happened on was the diaries of pioneer and homesteader women. So I was born and raised in the East Coast, and we were really, really not taught about, not taught much about the expansion west. And to our detriment, it's something that's really overlooked in at least my educational history. So I addressed myself to a series of archives, both the University of Texas at Austin and places online, and whittled it down to a few texts by two women. So that is Eleanor Pruitt Stewart, who is a homesteader, and Mary Alma Blankenship. Stewart was in Wyoming, and Mary Alma Blankenship was in Texas, in the Panhandle. And what drew me to these texts was how some of them are quite quotidian. It's like, this morning we washed our faces a little bit earlier than normal so that we could get the chickens. It's basically kind of everyday life. And then some of them are quite devastating, right in the same diary entry. So it'll be, we did this, we did that. Oh, and also my son died and my husband insisted on making the coffin himself, because he's a carpenter. So you have this juxtaposition of the beautiful and the devastating and the day-to-day, which I think was so important to the women in that situation at that time, which is to say the kind of late 19th century, early 20th century. Mainly, with the guitars, what I really wanted to do was surround the voices in a way that didn't make the guitars feel like just accompaniment. So there are large extended periods of time when the chorus isn't singing, or they function more as atmosphere in tandem with the guitars. And that was a really important thing. Also knowing that Conspirare were so good at that, that they can go from being narrative partners to being more about atmosphere. And you hear that, there are a bunch of places where you hear that, but really specifically in the third part, where suddenly they become this kind of howling presence. And I also wanted to access in some oblique way the American folk music vernacular, which again is really not part of my output. I've set a lot of English folk songs, but I'd never actually dealt with American folk songs before. So you hear a couple of things in the background, which of course the guitar helps with evoking that. It is so great, and it was such a gift to hear this recording during this lockdown. It was really one of the few things that kind of brought me joy in the beginning of it, because it's so well done. And it was such a magical thing when we put it together in Texas a few years ago with Craig and the three guitar quartets from LA and from Texas and from Dublin. And it really felt like a kind of dream to make it together. And this is such a lovingly made document of that, and it takes on its own new life, and it gives me enormous pleasure to know that all of you now can hear it and can engage with the piece, and of course with my colleagues' music as well. Context is everything, and I think this is a wonderful disc in terms of all of our music, I think, works in a really good handshake. So yes, recordings are great.
I am actually listening a lot to the singing guitar on repeat, but when I'm not listening to that, I'm listening mostly right now to Bonnie Raitt.
I've enjoyed getting up north and enjoying all of the Minnesota lakes.
The music that I've been listening to a lot recently is some wonderful gospel music by Patti LaBelle, sung by Mavis Staples, and by Deborah Joy Winans. There's one specific piece that I just enjoy listening to so much, and it's called A Leak in This Old Building. It was written by LaShawn Pace, and she does this totally roof-raising rendition of it, performance of it. And there's also a version of it done by Voice of Atlanta, which is extremely grounding.
Oh gosh, I have a lot of favorites in that recording session. I just enjoyed recording the whole CD. But one thing that is on top of the list is hearing Estelí Gómez sing the Muley piece. It's such a masterclass in artistry, and her voice is just beautiful and soaring. And I really, really cherish that moment a lot.
I guess the memory that stands out right now is being able to scratch that itch during the Houston performance, forever captured in the CD artwork. Just kidding. My favorite moment are the first few chords of the Muley perfectly intonated by Consperati.
Working with the classical guitarists was, for me, very special. Their sound was just incredibly unique and just so mesmerizing. This very unusual color palette, and having the chance to hear that and sing on top of that and create music together was just a very unique experience. It was awesome.
If I had to relate one strong memory of the recording experience, it's how Consperare and Craig and Anne and all the team made us all feel like family. Aside from working up such wonderful music with them. And also, I have a pretty good memory of some barbecue on the way to Houston. This little town off the freeway, I forget the name of the barbecue, but you know it's good when couples drive up in their lawnmowers to get it, so it was good. The whole experience was amazing. Thanks Anne, thanks Craig, thanks Consperare for everything. Thank you.
A favorite moment or memory that I have of this recording project, and it's probably true for every project that we get to do at Consperare, is that moment when we are all at rehearsal for the first time and we're sitting there and there's a buzz, there's an excitement. I mean, you're sitting with friends that you haven't seen. It's almost like having a giant family reunion in some respects. And then Craig gets up there and, you know, instrumentalists get ready. And then all of a sudden we have this moment and everyone's focus, it just goes, and we all just tune in right at the same time. And that magic moment, whenever Craig is just about to start us off, that's my favorite memory of everything we get to do. It's this intensity, this joy, this anticipation, this here we are about to make some incredible music with some incredible artists. And that's my favorite memory.
I have so many great memories of this collaboration with Craig and Consperare. In fact, for us in LAGQ, I think it's really one of the most fulfilling and creative and just exciting projects we've ever done in our 40 years together. But I do have one particular memory that really sticks out for me. In Kyle Smith's incredible setting of the Star Spangled Banner, there's a long passage where we just sit there, we don't have to play, and we got to be enveloped by the glorious sound of Consperare and looking up at Craig with this beatific smile and transported demeanor. It just, for me, it's a frozen moment in time of just pure musical expression and being in the moment, and I'll always cherish that.
So beautiful. And Bill also gets the prize for product placement. Very nicely done. I saw that little CD right behind him, and that was so great. Just like they do in the big news shows. It was great when you have a new book. Yeah. Well done. Gorgeous to hear you all. I want to mention, too, there's only so much we can do in an hour, and And we're sorry also not to have any moments of sharing actual music from our 12 guitar, because we're trying to do a little bit of a tease. So those of you who haven't heard it will hear the glory of that 12 guitars together too. But it's we're sorry to miss even just get a half a minute of that tonight. And I want to acknowledge the extraordinary ensemble that was. I think I've shared it before too with a few of you. But I've had a couple of composers write to me, and one of them I thought was pretty special. He said, you know, 12 guitars and choir, I didn't know that was a thing. And I said, you know, it really wasn't a thing. It got created here, and it's now a thing. So maybe we'll see little 12 tets popping up. Who knows? We've got to hear something from our artists, and I know that was a little melange of sort of playlist and favorite moments. So thanks for riding that fun journey with us, and thank you artists who helped us with that. I want to take a few minutes, and by the way, we're going to just take a few minutes here to just talk live with a few of the artists, but then be sure you're hanging on, because LA Guitar Quartet has a super cool thing they're going to share that we're going to hear together and see together. Anyway, that's all I'll say, but just be sure you're hanging on, because it's super awesome. So first of all, while we're on gallery mode, I just want to say, if you sang or played or wrote a piece for this, would you maybe just spend 10 seconds waving so that everyone can kind of see you? Just couldn't wave if you sang or played on this CD. So we get to see all of our artists waving little hands. Everybody, if you played or sang. Thank you. It's great. I don't see all of our hands, but anyway, I just wanted to say a little artist hand shout out. And now let's invite some folks. I'm just going to go first names here, because you can all have this feeling of being part of the family, all of you guests too. I'm going to ask Bill and Estelle and Janet and Enrico and Alejandro to unmute. And I'm just going to just ask maybe for each of you to share a thought or a moment. I'm going to start out with Estelle, who's representing all the singers here. She had some real, truly tightrope walking to do with an extraordinary solo in Nico's piece, the fourth movement, and actually the fifth movement officially, but that's a longer story. We'll share you that later over another beer, I guess. But it's an extraordinary movement, one that's technically so demanding, but so the heart center of the piece as well. And we all admired the way she stepped into both the technical demands, but then also was so committed, so fierce to keep the heart center of that thing ever present. She's the one who sang the title words of the piece, "How Little You Are," kind of understanding in the vastness of this universe how little you are, and the marvel of that, and the way that Nico said it is not a diminishing thing. It's in finding that perspective. So I'm going to open with her. And Estelle, just say hello and just share something about the experience for you, but just congratulations. It's beautiful. I can't wait for people to hear you.
Thank you so much. Oh, it's so good to see everybody. I think just a memory, since I didn't, you know, get my memory video in, would just be to briefly say that when we first did this piece, when we first started exploring it, the movement where I was singing this solo has such a very extended amount of time with the guitars just being beautiful and sparse and just holding space in a breathtaking way. So when we did the premiere, standing there and being there for 3.5 minutes in just total silence and total, you know, it's like, it's some of that unruffled, you know, duck on the surface, but you're paddling like crazy underneath. So that was a memory in which I kind of felt like I was being reminded of, you know, oh yeah, you know how to swim, right? Because it was just, you had to hold space and then be thrown into, I can't, you know, I don't even remember. It's a big jump, a lot of big jumps at the beginning. So anyway, that was a special moment when we first premiered it for me, of kind of, oh right, I can still get scared. and it can still work out just fine, right? And then in this recording, it was a really special thing to feel like saying the words, but when you get among such grandeur, you get to feel how little you are, and what a metaphor that is for singing with other people, and singing with this group particularly. Conspirare is grandeur everywhere, all at all times, and to be a part of it is to recognize your small but deeply, you know, special part of the whole. So it's really special to see everybody here. Thanks.
Oh, beautiful. Yes, and you were really a model of virtuosity and vulnerability all in one. It was truly a great masterclass, as Enrico said. Some really beautiful solo work throughout Nico's piece, also with Laura and Stephen, Simon, just exquisite work. Also beautiful solo quartet in Rina's piece, and Esteli was also doing high-flying work there. The whole ensemble sang with such exquisite sensitivity. It is exquisite. Alejandro, talk to us a little bit about an experience. Share us something. Alejandro, who is representing the Texas Guitar Quartet, we're so proud of, and say hello and join us.
Hello, everybody. My memory is from the rehearsal week leading up to the premiere back in 2015. It was the middle of the week, and we were just exhausted, on the verge of burning out. And then Craig approached everybody, all the individual groups, and said, hey, we're going to hang back for about 20 minutes or so. All the ensembles are going to perform a song for each other. And so when after the rehearsal was done, we just hung back, and the Dublin Guitar Quartet played this really cool Stravinsky piece, and everybody went nuts. It's like, yeah. And then we played one of Joe Williams's piece, this really I think it was from The Lodger, the silent film that he composed for the quartet. And then my favorite moment of that evening is actually two favorite moments, because after we played, the LA Guitar Quartet performed, and for a classical guitarist here in the LA Guitar Quartet, 5 feet away from you, it's like being in front of the Rolling Stones. So it was incredible, and I think they played, I want to say they played Kumbakin. I'm trying to remember the piece, but I was such a fanboy at the time that I just don't remember it. And then to top it off, Conspirare was like, all right, hold my beer. And all the singers enveloped the guitarists, and you guys sang a spiritual in the round. And to this day, every time I think about it, that moment, I get goosebumps. And right now I'm on the verge of tears, just because it was such a magical moment. And it just helped bring the ensemble together. It brought us closer.
Mm. That was a special day. Thank you for sharing that. That was really special. We did it right there on stage at Bass.
Yeah.
Concert Hall. Thank you, Alejandro. Beautiful. Oh, Janet, the more recently birthed Austin Guitar Quartet. So beautiful to have you guys with us. Share a memory or a moment, if you would.
Yes, for sure. Oh, we had such a great time with all of you recording and in the concerts. It was so wonderful to work with such a wonderful group, and with three quartets. When do you ever get to do that? And with the entire choir, we were just blown away by all of you, just your gorgeous voices. I think one of my moments, my favorite moments, was when, a little bit like Al's actually, when it was our first rehearsal all together as a large ensemble last year, and you, Craig, had us all positioned, I guess, all of us guitarists, like around you in a semicircle, and then all of the chorus completely surrounding us. And you started rehearsal, and we just all started together, and I was talking to people about it after, and just the sound, having that surround sound of all of you around us, and that's the first time we're hearing the Muley together, was just so beautiful. It was so gorgeous. We were just enveloped in that sound, and it was just unreal. It was funny because I was talking to the quartet about it after, and we nearly stopped playing because we just wanted to take all of that in. I feel guitar and voice work so well together. So to have that many guitars and that many voices was just one of the most beautiful things, and kind of set the excitement off for the concerts and for the recording. We're so thankful to Consperare, just to everyone who has been involved. It really did feel like you all made us feel like we were part of the family. And we just had a wonderful experience. Craig, you just sort of always made us feel all at home and at ease, and at the same time, you know, kept us at the very best standard we could be. So it was just such a beautiful experience to go through, and we were so sad when we were leaving. I still remember driving back, but at the same time realized we had created something very special. And going back and hearing it now, just hearing the CD in full form, we're just blown away. So thank you all for everything.
Thank you.
I'm so glad we have this, and that it's coming out now, that everybody gets to hear it. So.
It's very special. Thank you. And such beautiful quartet also. These are just 12 virtuoso players, you guys. And then Bill, with Los Angeles Guitar Quartet, share anything you'd like in this moment of celebration. And then maybe I'll just ask if you would, Bill, go ahead at the end of your sharing and introduce your cool present, special present to us today.
Well, I have one special moment that I have to say, which is one of the rehearsals in Austin. It was, the word got out to Anne that it was my wife's birthday, my wife Colette's birthday. She's right here. And she got the greatest happy birthday anyone has ever gotten. It was 12 guitars and all of Consperare, and it started very, you know, kind of softly, and the ending was just, you know, like Brahms or something, you know, it really meant a lot to both of us. So I want to thank everybody for that beautiful gift. But, you know, we've heard so much about the unbelievable artistry of the composers and the singers and the cellist and some of the guitar players. But there's the center, the spiritual center of this entire project, the glue, the inspiration is Craig. And Craig's utter devotion to this and professionalism and sensitivity and empathy and respect and teaching, it blows my mind, like what we heard him say and the way he expresses what he wants to say. And for the four of us, we're used to guitar players talking to guitar players. We don't know how singers talk to singers, but I saw him with just a small gesture and a choice of words transform things in such a, it's a kind of a musical alchemy that he's able to create. And for us, it's just what a joy, what a privilege, what an honor to get to work with him. So I want to thank Craig Hella Johnson.
Thank you very much. That's beautiful. Thank you. Such a privilege. Thank you, Bill. And you guys, you know, you are the thread that, through this entire project, played through all these works and collaborated with Rena so closely on the arrangement, and with Kyle, the back and forth that you guys engaged with too, and just such a devotion to this whole project. And it's a lifelong special kind of legacy project, I think, that everyone has co-created, and you guys played such a role. Please tell us what we're about to see.
Yeah. So, you know, we really, at one point, Anne said, wouldn't it be great if the quartet could play a tune, you know, and it's like, well, we're not, you know, together right now, but we actually have this really cool video that no one has seen yet. This is like a world premiere, and it's also very appropriate, because we played a benefit concert in Paradise, California, in November. This is for the victims of the campfire, the horrible campfire in Paradise. It was the first performance at the somehow the Paradise Center for Arts didn't burn down. And so we played there. It was a benefit. And most of the audience were people who were victims of the fire. So that's where this was filmed. And this is an arrangement by Matt. You already heard Matt play a little tune earlier of one of the great tunes of all time. It's The Wind Cries Mary by Jimi Hendrix.
Oh, you guys, thank you so much. That is so awesome. Matt, what a great arrangement. Oh, and such fantastic playing. That is very special to get to see that, our first eyes on that. Thank you, thank you, thank you. It's so great. You know, I'm sort of with Alejandro too, where before we first got to meet and do this too, I was in great respect, admiration, and awe of you guys. And I was a little nervous to start. And it's so beautiful to kind of have that experience of that nervous expectation and then to become really friends, brothers, collaborators in this. It's been so rich. You know, this is the gift of musical collaboration too, is that it becomes a deep friendship, and you know, our roots grow deep all of a sudden. Thank you. This was so awesome. What a great way to close our musical portion here. We're just going to have just a couple of things. Once again, celebrate this new project. Send it, share it with your friends, let it know it's in the world. And up this Friday, it releases Spotify, Apple, all the usual suspects. But, you know, we're big believers in buying that beautiful product too. So go ahead and just have one. The notes are wonderful. It's great to have the photographs. You want to have that picture of Matt with his hand up in his face. That's really important. Which I hadn't even noticed until the video, and I'm like, oh yeah, I mean, talk about, yeah, that's great. But it's a really special thing to have, and we want to send you that beautiful essay and note from Annette Carlozzi too. We'd love for you to have that, so please do find it. I want to say a special shout out here, first of all, someone in Austin who is kind of a center for all things guitar, but kind of all things really beautiful too, I will say, is Matt Hensley. He's on, and I just want to say, Matt, if you want to wave and just from your square, you are so special too, and you, I don't quite see you, but I know you're there, and thank you for joining us. We're so super thrilled. And Matt's one amazing human being. Thank you for all that you've done to support this project moving forward. Also, super grateful to two people who were very, very generous to support this project, Dale and Tina Noble, dear friends to Conspirare and to just supporting good things in this world in general. We love you guys so much. Thank you very, very much. They're on with us tonight, and we just are so grateful to you. The National Endowment for the Arts was super supportive of this in some big ways, and so we thank the National Endowment. They've been through a lot of challenges in these recent years, and we're so grateful for their carrying on and for their support. City of Austin Cultural Arts Division, the Texas Commission on the Arts, so much support for this project. And so just congratulations again to all of you who performed, who wrote music for this. Thank you all for being here tonight. And thank you for those of you who listen and support us and our friends in this work. You create the space in which this is created. I think we're gonna take a moment for our goodbyes and let it be a kind of a glorious cacophony. Let's just unmute us so we can finally be together. And I see some different things coming off.
Beautiful.
Bill and Colette. Oh, gosh.
Oh, hey, Matt. So good.
He's in the hair, Matt.
There is no fun.
What do you think, man?
Hi, Jay.
I'm working hard on it.
Love it.
Oh, my God. Hearing everybody.
It's like rehearsal. Really, so this beautiful project. So amazing.
So good.
Thank you.